Early this month, the prehistoric adventure saga Quest for Fire opened in London, following in the wake of its huge box office success in America. The film is set 80,000 years ago, at a time when rival tribes of primitive Homo sapiens and Neanderthals clashed in life and death struggles for the possession of fire, the key to survival. The story charts the progress of three courageous warriors forced to venture beyond the safety of their tribal land when their life-sustaining flame is lost during a battle with marauding Neanderthals. Their perilous quest for the priceless gift, which they possess but do not know how to create anew, pits them against the challenge of treacherous terrain, savage tribes and predatory beasts. The director of this science fantasy epic is Jean-Jacques Annaud, who is with me here in the studio today. Welcome to Imperial College. Okay. Well, the first question I'd like to ask you is, when was the idea for Quest of Fire conceived? First of all, whose idea was it in the first place?
Well, it's a kind of sparkle that happened 4 years ago, yeah. Between a writer called Gérard Brache, who normally wrote for Polanski. He refused to write to write for French directors.
Yeah.
We met one day for another project, and so very early that we had a common interest in anthropology, and we're very excited about that period of primal man. And on the first meeting, we were meeting for another purpose, and we decided to go on that very strange project, and we are very enthusiastic about
it. Yes, so it was your interest in anthropology which really attracted you to it, was it?
Yes, as well as I saw that there was a tremendous appeal for a good adventure. I mean, an exciting adventure is in an unknown world. You know, it's very exciting when you're a director to think that you are going to do something new. To do a science fiction film in the future, as usual, is banal. Mm. You've seen that before on screen. You've seen those rockets. You've seen those strange people in their suit with the zips everywhere. And it's not exciting. You just say to your costume designer, you say, do like an Alien. You know, they did it well, then do something similar. In that film, in Quest for Fire, it was so exciting to deal with a new material, with not knowing exactly how we could achieve it. You know, when we were together with Gérard Brache, he said, do you think we can have mammoth? I said, yes, of course. He said, how are you going to do it? I said, this is my problem. Don't worry. Just we'll write mammoth. And I remember he wrote three mammoths. And I said, you're kidding. I want 20 mammoth, at least a herd of mammoth, not two mammoth.
When did actually production start, actual correlating all the work together?
It started 4 years ago.
4 years ago?
Yes, very early on, when I had this sparkle, for another reason, I went to Los Angeles, met a friend of mine who was a producer, and he asked me if I had an idea for a new film, and I just mentioned very casually that I had this idea of set a long time ago. And he looked at me with big eyes like that. He said, you've got a producer. I want to produce this. This is marvelous. This is extraordinary. Don't see anyone else. And I said, I have to see somebody else then. Because I want to know if I'll find more excitement. And in fact, I had people saying, what? A film about what? Primitive man? Oh, no, please, no. People are interested in future, not in the past. Kind of answer, you know. Then I was wise to stay with Michael Graskov, and then we started very, very early writing the screenplay for Columbia, and then we were turned down, you know, usual story, like Star Wars, went turned down by the same company, and we went to Fox, to 20th Century Fox, and started very calm, very small here in London. We had an office, and we did a pre-production for 2 years. It's enormous.
What kind of work did you actually do during that pre-production?
Casting sessions.
Yeah.
Very difficult, of course, to find the right people to do the film. And location. To find in today the wide landscapes of the period. Well, it was very nice for me and my location manager because we've been everywhere. We've been in Finland, Iceland, northern Canada, Tanzania, Kenya, everywhere. But it was very difficult to find. Because the world today, you know, we've got factories everywhere and roads and airstrips, everything.
Now, I understand there's a special language written for this film by Anthony Burgess. Now, was he actually present during shooting, actually on location?
No.
So, well, how therefore was the language put down on paper?
Well, what happened is we had to face two steps. The first step was to write a screenplay with the visual and the sound, which makes movies, in fact. You know, motion pictures is about visual and sound. Then we had to write a whole screenplay without any dialogue. Then we wrote some dialogue in a non-language that we invented. Then we asked Anthony Burgess to help us, because he's, before being a writer, he's been a linguist, and he wrote the first Indo-European dictionary. Very few people know that, but he's, you know, he knows something like 12 languages. And then I came to see him in Monaco, where he lives, and we had a fantastic and terrific session of creating words which could have been the roots of the Indo-European words. We had to invent, of course. And then after that, we asked Desmond Morris to give us the right gesture to fit with the word. You know, for instance, if I say give today, I would say this, give. Apes do that, but a little Italian do this. And Africans, they do that. Then we had to pick the right attitude and the right word. Then Anthony Burgess for that said, we could use do, like donare in Latin, but do, it's more do. And we had 400 words to find out. Then we had very interesting session here with a group of mime actors and Desmond Morris and Anthony Burgess, and we had to work out the whole concept of gestures and language. And then I trained my actors for 6 months
here in London. Looking at the faces of some of the people who took part in the film, they don't look, the bone structure doesn't look quite should we say human as we know it today. What was the makeup involved in the film? Did it involve putting masks?
When you say that, you know, humans, we Neanderthal man or even Homo erectus or Homo habilis were human. Next door is the National Natural History Museum, where you have faces of Neanderthal. And a few days ago, I was in the Neanderthal Museum near Dusseldorf in Germany. And what happened is Neanderthal man had a very small eyebrow, you know, but very strong ridges here and no chin at all. Then we had to find actors that we could transform in not having chin. Well, you cannot chop a chin, right? I know my makeup artist, was Chris Tucker, was very disappointed that he could not, you know, take it off. But we had to find people with no chin, for instance, to be the Neanderthal, while other tribes involved in the film had a chin. Then it was a very, very difficult casting session, because I had each time I was developing something in the makeup lab, I had to find the corresponding actors. Then for 1 year we've been researching and coming with all kind of faces. It's very difficult with people today to recreate what was the look of the period. And for that, you know, we have all those bones, and we don't know for sure what was the color of the skin or how hairy they were or the color of the eyes, but we know what was the bone structure, and that we respected.
Okay, well, we'll break off there for a few moments to have a look at a clip from the film. I believe there's a saying in show business, never work with children and animals. Well, you worked with, I believe, elephants, lions and various other sundry creatures. What were some of the more hairier moments of working with these animals? Many dangers involved? Presumably there must have been.
Yes, but people are very disappointed that there was no nasty accident on this film. I mean, we had trouble, of course, with the elephants, with the mammoth, because Jimmy Chipperfield was in charge of those elephants. And I had, you know, my cameras, and the mammoth on the top of a little hill. And they said to me, "It's very easy to have this animal coming towards the camera. You put a female, you know, they're like all of us; they go for the female." and then I had my whistle, and I said, "Turn over," and I whistle, and they take the pegs or the out and the chains, and the mammoth. Didn't went for the female here, but for a little tent that we had where we had all the equipment. And they all went on the tent and destroyed like $500,000 of equipment. And then we say, the Jimmy Chipperfield ran to me and said, "Oh my God, no, tomorrow we'll do the same, but don't put the tent, of course." Then I did the same the next day with the little female and the elephants, and then I whistled. And then the elephant turned their back and went the other direction because they saw that, in fact, what they wanted was the big tent where they used to live, which was the other side. Unfortunately, in between, there was a marsh. And they all went into the marsh. So that was the end of the scene, of course. And we had to rebuild it, to take them out from the marshes, yes. Which was a day work because, you know, it's. Plus, they were all.
And presumably, the skins they were wearing were.
Yes, were entirely destroyed, and they were carefully made.
Well, how long did that one mammoth skin actually take to
make?
Yeah.
A skin was like. 2 or 3 weeks of work.
Yeah.
I know that we had a lot of old ladies putting hairs on. Yes. Yeah. And each elephant had a special costume. You know, they were handmade for, like by a tailor. Plus, it was not the costume with like a baby suit. You know, it was a something like 15 different pieces, and it took us nearly a day to make one elephant. As a mammoth, it was. I didn't want any mechanical involved in this film. And it was. I was aiming for real. You know, all of it has been shot in on location. Every animal is a real one. There is no mechanical things.
Concerning the actual costumes for the rest of the cast, how many people did you actually have to kit out with special clothing?
All of them. It's like 250.
200, yeah.
Yes. And each actor needed one makeup artist because there was 3 hours of makeup and 2 hours to undo the makeup each day.
Really?
Yeah. And sometimes I had 60 actors on the set. Plus I had the wigs were so difficult and the costumes. Some days I had 300 people on the set. 300 technicians.
I said earlier that the film has done very well in America. Why do you think audiences have flocked to see this film?
It's new.
Yeah.
It's new and it's an adventure. It's a story. I mean, it's people are they laugh and then they cry and you know, moviegoers. There are two levels in a film always. There is the basic: is it an entertainment or not? Is it an adventure or not? Is it a good story or not? And I think on that level the film works. And then on the top of that, there is new. It's a new approach. It's somebody yesterday, I think it's somebody at Rank, who is not distributing the film, was saying that it was a new approach of cinema entertainment, and I felt it was a great compliment.
Do you think, as well as the entertainment aspect, they've gone along to try and find out what their, shall we say, that their roots of their civilization were all about?
Well, you know, yes, of course. But you know, you have to make a distinction between what makes people go to movies and what makes them feel that they've seen a good film. It's very different. As you know, people often flock to a film for strange reasons. They're disappointed, but they flock again to the same kind of film, and they go out disappointed. Then the second level is to have them happy when they go out. And of course, when they go out, most of them have a strange feeling that they discovered some hidden parts of themselves. And I'm very pleased with that because then they liked my deep reasons to make that kind of film, which is my interest in anthropology and primitive people. One of my reasons, hidden reason, is I lived for a long period of my life in Africa.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I do care about primitive people just because I think that I'm very primitive inside, then that's why I can't care for primitive people.
What are your actual future plans as regards film production?
To take something like a week vacation.
Yes.
Do you think of that?
but what actual films will be involved in this later on?
I have many many temptations, but I haven't made any decision yet. Let me tell you, there is not going to be a Quest for Fire number two.
Yeah.
This is what you want
really?
To do.
Well, London seems to be going under a barrage of sequels at the moment.
You know, I'm not a factory.
Yeah.
And I'm not interested in turning myself into that.
Do you think somebody else will produce a Quest for Fire 2?
Oh, that I know already several Quest for Fire number 2.
Really?
Being prepared, yes.
Okay then, Jean-Jacques Annaud, thank you very much indeed for coming along to Imperial College.
Thank you.